When they shut the school gates, who will be there when you don't have your mates? Who can you beg on when you get your first pay? How do you make it last for more than one day? Who can you bank on with a place of your own? It's not just a rent. Have they got what it takes? Who can you bank on?
Who can you bank on?
Who can you trust?
Who can you trust?
You can bank on Westpac. Westpac, you can bank on us.
To show you parts of that program, a chance to relive all those fantastic expo memories. A chance to relive all the fun, the adventure and the excitement that made World Expo an experience beyond what any of us ever expected. This two-hour commercial-free special will have a look at the Expo closing ceremony and fireworks finale. But first, let's go back to April the 30th, when it all began.
10, 9, 8, 7, 6, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1. I now declare World Expo 88 well and truly open.
Leave your best girl home on a Saturday night.
I'll get around.
past 6 months, Anna and I have shared what has to be one of the best jobs in Australia, keeping tabs for Network 10 on all the activities here at Expo.
Now, at the heart of it have been the pavilions from all over the world. But what's made this Expo so outstanding are the entertainers from all over the world, the musicians, the jugglers, the comedians, the weird and the wonderful. They've literally been the life of the party.
Anna, just hold the cigarette right in your mouth, just like you're going to smoke it.
Okay, good, good. What if I don't smoke?
This is going to be a wonderful trick, Anna. Okay, just look out at all those nice people. All right. Okay, I'm going to knock it out with this whip. I love this trick. I hate the color green. Don't worry, I'm a professional. Look. Ow. That didn't hurt, Anna. I'm on drugs. All right, Anna. Here we go. On the count of three, lean forward just a little bit. One! One! Does it bother you that I'm crazy? Looking down your dress.
I love my job.
Here we go. You got a big nose, you know that?
Three. Oh.
And all.
Well, I heard about one of the strangest characters we met at Expo was Fred Garbo. So named because he usually performs in a garbage can. But he found the ones at Expo too small, especially for his latest act. While Fred Garbo was flying high with his newfound freedom from the garbage can, Pepper Kaminoff was putting himself into even tighter spots and getting laughs by the barrelful. Were so popular they became cult figures. Without a doubt, the most popular was Randy Burns, the Mechanical Man. Recalled for an encore season.
I haven't performed here since May, and I've missed all of you very much. I had to do shows all over the United States, and there's no place like Australia. Honestly, this is probably the best place I've ever worked in 10 years.
Black people like Randy Burns, Pepper Kaminoff and Fred Garbo were the real surprises of Expo. You stumbled across them when you came to see the big names in entertainment. And Expo drew some of the biggest.
You ready, screamers? Here we go. One, two, three. Almost. Well, I am getting a little older.
We're down Louisiana, across from New Orleans. We're back up in the woods amongst the evergreens. Stood a log cabin made of earth and wood. Lived a country boy named Johnny B. Good, who never ever learned to read or write so well. Come on, Craig, show us your stuff.
Energetic for a young person. Clap along, everybody. But right now we're going to have a little competition.
All right.
And I'll show you how rock and rolling is done with an audience, okay?
All right.
When I say yeah, you say yeah, everybody, and follow me closely. Watch this. Everybody say yeah! Yeah!
Drove through two hedges and ended up in a lake. Then I lost control of the car.
We were given an idea of what we're in for right from the start when the original Little River Band reformed for a concert on the first night of Expo.
How can I last another night alone without you? So far away. Things that you do. If I could hold you in my arms for just 1 minute of tonight, I know I'd say the words I find so hard to say to make it right. Each night away from you I see all the things you really mean.
Love is a bridge that links our hearts, keeping us close when we're apart. I always knew right from the start. Love is a bridge that runs from heart to heart. From heart to heart.
When they chose the site for World Expo 88, there was a real bonus. The Brisbane River. Four times a day, it's the venue for one of the most spectacular shows you'll ever see on water. Is going to be your lasting impression of World Expo 88? What would you consider, I guess, your personal highlight?
For me, I think the Acrocade is one of the things that I was most closely involved with in the overall entertainment plan. But, although I remember that most because I was involved, there's no really one particular thing. The marching band, the parades, more than anything, I guess, the feeling of getting 300 people to work together in a way to bring together an extraordinary program of entertainment, which turned out in the end to be far, far better than I could ever have planned. It was just one of those serendipity things that the right people came together in the right place at the right time, and the audience were here too.
When you stage an exposition such as this, the world comes to you. Walking through the pavilions is like being an international jet setter. Asia in the morning, Europe in the afternoon. You see more than 40 countries from every continent except South America have come to Brisbane, each bringing with them a unique aspect of their culture. If you wanted to see Australia in a different way, you couldn't do better than the Australian Pavilion.
Waters, broad vistas and new horizons of the Rainbow Experience, and discover all of the wonderful things there are to see and do in the Australian Pavilion. The Aussie Pav for short, the secrets in the eggs. Excuse me, here's the menu. Menu. Wish upon a star. Start here and go to the Rainbow Seven Theatre.
The animals of the Earth Mother come to say more than this. They come say that our creator, that rainbow serpent, she get weak with anger and grief for what we are doing to this earth. But here now, you fellas, you come sit down by my fire, warm yourselves, and I will tell you the story of how this world began.
It's our spiritual way, which is our connection with the land, the Earth Mother, and she is the Earth Mother. We cannot own the land. The land owns us. And so we have written it down because we feel that we must now share it with all the world's earth people.
Kabul, bring back the fire of knowledge to your children. Like the fire of that pretty stone in the ground, the one you call opal. The colors of the rainbow, the colors of life itself.
Australia, you're a special kind of magic feeling. Australia, we are Australia.
Australia,
Australia, you're a special kind of magic. Australia, you're a special kind of magic.
And Australia is a very special kind of land for a very special Australian. Roger Woodward came to Expo to play Beethoven. Roger Woodward, hailed throughout Europe and America for his interpretation of the classics. But his heart was still at home.
I'm going to Kununurra, where I've never been. I want to walk on the magic plain with the wonderful, wonderful trees, which I've described to you very carefully by the few people who've been there. There's a kind of special magic energy in this place. And it's, I think, probably the closest thing to heaven that many Australians who've been away from Australia for a long time want.
He's played with the leading orchestras in the best concert halls all over the world. But there's one place in Australia he'd just love to play.
The best bush opera house in Australia is in Gulgong, between the news agency and the milk bar.
It may not have been up to the standard of Dame Nellie Milbury at Gulgong, but Kate Sobrano was setting them alight on the river stage.
When the designers laid out the plans for the entertainment venues here at Expo, they looked to Europe, where the piazza is the heart of town. This is our piazza, and it's the venue for Entertainment Unlimited.
That's right. Rev it up, little boy, and ride. She said, let's ride. Rev it up. Let's ride. Rev it up, little boy, and ride.
If there's a word to describe entertainment in the piazza, it's variety.
In one night we went 7, 8 and 9, 7 o'clock roller skating, 8 o'clock ballroom dancing and 9 o'clock wood chopping. You can't get much more variety than that.
David Hamilton, the producer of Piazza Entertainment. One of the most unusual shows he brought to Expo was an updated version of the old-fashioned wood chops called Axe Attack.
That was something that was a big challenge because most people remember the wood chop at the RNA, which has been around for a long time, but we tried to add male dancers with axes as well as acrobatic acts where they're juggling wood and fire, and as well as a slack wire between the two trunks. And believe it, in there somewhere, there is real wood chopping as well.
David Hamilton had a strange rule of thumb for his acts. If it would work in a shopping centre, it would work in the piazza.
Having performed in shopping centres, I think you find that the quality of the show is what keeps an audience. And in my opinion, here at Expo, if a show's good, the public going by will say, oh, that looks interesting, yes, I'll watch that. Or else they have the choice that, I'm not impressed with that, I think I'll go and see a pavilion. It's the same when you're shopping. If the show's good, you'll stop and watch it. If not, you'll get on with doing your shopping.
David had no trouble stopping people dead in their tracks when he brought to Expo some of the best acrobats in the world.
We're looking at the lighter side of the World Fair. But not all the fun came from professional entertainers. Some of the best moments came from the members of the public themselves. Good sports who happened to be in the right places at the wrong times, like the Expo Olympics.
In light of Brisbane's bid for the 1996 Olympics, what we thought we would do would be show the rest of the world what they're going to have to put up with when they come over here, because some of the events that we have here are slightly different to the ones that they're used to in other countries, you see.
Slightly different? I suppose they could describe cow pat tossing, thong clapping, cooey calling and crocodile tossing. In her day, triple Olympian, Dawn Fraser may have been able to beat a crocodile swimming, but she needs training when it comes to crocodile throwing.
Yeah, by the hell, here we go, okay.
Fortunately, the highly trained and finely tuned international competitors had much better aim.
Now, get hold of the, good at the leg, not the body, underbody, because you might grab him in a tender part and he might yelp or something. Ready? One, two, three! Oh, what about this?
Now, what sort of Bush Olympics would it be without cooey calling, which should have been Australia by a country mile?
You go, coo-ee. Can you do that? Coo-ee. Take a big breath. Ooh. Put this up here. Coo-ee. All right.
The final event in these historic games was designed to bring out the cultural side of Australian competition, thong clapping.
games were far from over. Outside the Australian pavilion, they were just getting warmed up. This was a contest for Expo staff.
This is so much fun!
It was a relay race around Australia, but no ordinary relay race.
Okay. Right. And you've got to change the thongs, which is smeared with Vegemite over there, at each change, and also hand the banana on, which is the baton. I think the last person also has to eat the banana. So you've got to look after the banana. Yeah.
They start on the rocking ram, change into Swaggy's clothes, and head for Sydney to gulp down a cold pie and peas. Then it was on to Canberra, where a pile of lamingtons were waiting to be devoured. And up to Darwin to make a pyramid of beer cans.
Go easy, go easy, time. Go easy.
Take your time.
Take your time. Go, good on your entertainment.
Finally, it was back to the ram and down the banana. But the entertainment division team was disqualified because they hadn't followed all the rules.
So she did what was required, and her mouth was empty before the other ones. But she still did it.
The judges were unmoved, and victory went to the team from the Victorian Pavilion. This is one piece of entertainment that visitors to Expo will long remember. The Aquacade and a show called Bly's Follies. It was more than an offbeat history lesson. It was a lesson in grace and beauty of synchronized swimming and the daring of the world's best high divers. Australian Pavilion, they were more down to earth.
Oh, that's what I call one hot furnace. What temperature is it?
1250 degrees Celsius. It's pretty warm.
A souvenir of Expo that was pure gold. And this is the end product. Jewellery from Western Australia's Gold and Diamonds by Stuart Devlin. They have about $8 million worth of jewellery from the gold and diamond mines of Western Australia, and all of it can be yours for a price.
Yeah. Now, Lisa, I must say I quite fancy that one in the middle.
Well, if you like that one, that's the largest cut diamond in Australia, 10 carats worth.
Gee, and how much would that set me back?
Out of the piggy bank, about $230,000.
But the piece de resistance has to be an exquisite sculpture in gold.
Yes, it's Stuart Devlin's one of his most prized pieces, the Pixie Egg.
Very practical, obviously.
Very practical. Valued at $210,000. You couldn't wear it as a piece of jewellery.
Definitely not.
Lisa, this is what I call a little something to wear around the house.
Yes, this little something is actually valued at $95,000 and called the sea spray necklace.
So we're getting cheaper.
Coming down the range a little, Anna, yes.
But you wouldn't want to have double chins, would you, wearing it?
A little uncomfortable with those with the double chin, yes.
Very modern technology. This is a video cassette. I am a video cassette player. Thank you.
Take a walk around Expo and sometimes you wonder if sanity is a rare commodity.
You're looking for a nice girl to settle down with?
Yes, I'm looking for the nice girl.
Me?
Yeah?
Yeah. Some weirdos at Expo, I'll tell ya.
They go by the name the Sound Steppers, but these musical stilt walkers, Colin Offord and Celine Donegan, call themselves exotic urban animals. Their instruments include bamboo flutes, keys, money, trophies, wrist rattles, and Holden brand lion gongs. You'd know them better as hubcaps. Was madness. From South Africa came the wonderful talent of Ladysmith Black Mambazo.
Expo has changed our lives. If nothing else, we've all learned the gentle art of queuing. The lesson begins up to an hour before Expo opens. And when the clock strikes 10, that's the start of the great race.
Certainly in a hurry.
Yes.
What's all the rush?
Oh, I'll try and get there before everybody. Yes.
Good luck.
I want to get down to the New Zealand Pavilion.
Oh, good luck. You reckon you can make it before the others?
No, no hope. Not now.
So I'm trying to get on the monorail.
We've had 2 days here, and we want to get into the Russian exhibition, which we haven't seen yet.
And we've got to leave tomorrow.
We're just looking for a fun day.
The winners of the great race got to the head of the queue. The losers had to wait and wait outside the New Zealand Pavilion up to 5 hours. But for some, there was a whole new life at the end of the line.
Some people are getting married from waiting in the queue.
They met.
And often at the front, people have been waiting a while. They sort of have teamed up in a group and you can hear them planning what they're going to do through the rest of their day. Families sort of adopt an older person who's waiting with them, big friendships. And also, we have to have a cut-off point. So often people have cut off from the people they were talking to. And are sort of waving goodbye and giving phone numbers and addresses where they can meet up again. So it's good. I suppose it makes their wait a little less longer. We give out magazines for them to read in the queue, and they also have entertainment in the form of our stage and sort of video monitors going on all the time, which they can look at.
So, I mean, at the New Zealand Pavilion, you could almost turn queue waiting into a real social activity.
Oh, you could, that's for sure.
There was no need to queue for one of the most polished performances at Expo, the world's only full-time professional marching band, the Expo City Marching Band.
Thank you.
locations at Expo, without a doubt, one of the most unusual was Switzerland. It's been only in recent years that the technology has been developed to enable the Swiss to bring their gondolas and ski slopes to Queensland. It was a long way from St. Moritz, but you didn't have to stretch the imagination too far to put yourself into the Alps. The instructors were all from Switzerland, and the snow, although it was Queensland made, was the real thing. Without a doubt, one of the strangest sights we saw in the 6 months of Expo was a man-sized platypus expertly negotiating skiing down the man-made slope. I can tell you that was no mean feat.
All that has been written in the scriptures about the Son of Man is about to be accomplished.
The Iona Passion Play, a pageant of the last days of Christ. Begun at Brisbane's Iona College 30 years ago, it played every year somewhere in Australia. This year it played on Expo's River Stage in conjunction with the Holy See Pavilion's special day. The Vatican treasures, memorabilia of the popes, works of art in gold, silver, marble, oils and tapestry, all tell the same story as the Passion Play.
Those hands that had rested tenderly on the leper opened the eyes of the blind, touched broken hearts. Those hands were fastened with nails. The feet that had trodden the streets and byways of Galilee on errands of mercy and love were pinned to the cross. This was the return made to him for his life of devotedness.
Back wander bright, white leather hat, a head soaked in mud and jeans. Oh, rusted moon, a hellfire to go. Sapphire masterpiece of sin.
People, it's been a captive market for the corporations which have set up their own pavilions. As a promotional vehicle, it's absolutely second to none, and that's why they've spent tens of millions of dollars showing us the technology that'll take us into the next century. We'll be right back.
you do it. You play the guitar on the MTV. That ain't working, that's the way you do it. Money for nothing and your chicks for free. Now that ain't working, that's the way you do it. Let me tell you, damn guys ain't dumb. Maybe get a pistol on your little finger.
Maybe get. While the corporate pavilions were turning the clock forward to the 21st century, at the Lyric Theatre, it was being turned back to the 19th century. In the hierarchy of classical ballet, there are few companies that compare with England's Royal Ballet, and few ballets better than Swan Lake. They were here for a special British Week at Expo. Was taking us back to another place and another time. On the River Stage, so too was singer Normie Rowe in his highly acclaimed role in Les Miserables. Was just one of a galaxy of stars here for a very special Queensland Day concert on the River Stage. The performer everyone had come to see was John Denver.
I come to Australia, as many people do, to see the old koala hitch a ride on a kangaroo, to hear somebody call me mate and call somebody blue, to hear an aborigine play a didgeridoo.
While he was here, John revealed plans to write another song which could rival this one.
To sail on a dream, on a crystal clear ocean, to ride on the breast of a wild raging storm, to work on the surface of life and the living, in search of the answers to questions unknown. To be part of the movement, part of the growing, part of beginning to understand. Things that you've shown us, the stories you tell.
whose inspiration for the work was Australia's round-the-world sailor, Kay Cotty.
I'm pretty enamoured with Kay Cotty, the sailor. Yeah, I think that's a great, great feat. And somebody in Sydney yesterday said, Johnny, write a song about that. And I might do that. I'd love to learn how to sail. That's one of the things in my list of priorities when I get a little bit of time. One of the things I'd most like to do is learn how to sail, and especially at as close to the level as she sails as I could come. You know, just the thought of, you know, I'm pretty good in the mountains, and if I have a bunch of people to take care of, I can do that. But to captain a ship on the open sea, that's pretty far out. I'd like to be able to do that.
Expo probably thought they were going to be entertained, but a lot of people, often much to their embarrassment, found out they were the entertainment.
Give me a kiss. Give me a kiss.
What is your name? Never mind, we'll call her Dick. Anyway, now, Dick, put your hands by your side. Head forward slightly from the waist. Lick your head right up. Lick your lips. If you don't, I will.
Very good.
That's it. Place the cigarette loosely between your lips. Ha, ha, ha. And don't move. Here we go. Ready? I love doing that.
It's not quite Formula One. These open wheelers are rear-engined, parent-powered. Of course, you've got to have an official starter. And an official photographer for the photo finish. Eden tries to organise the TV coverage right down to the race cam. Organizes a cheering crowd. Now, with nothing more to be said, the race begins.
Now you're going to learn how to make breakfast in the morning. Now, you just follow the dances. You hit the lemon. Hold it, hold it, hold it. And you squeeze the orange. And so on. You pump the banana. And the coffee. Pump the orange. Push the banana. Grind the coffee.
The unexpected hits of Expo was ballroom dancing. For months it was a regular event in the Piazza, a venue that normally holds 3,000 people. Just about every week the ballroom dancing drew crowds of 5,000. Organisers, this was the turning point for ballroom dancing, the biggest interest since the 40s. But one of the most awe-inspiring performances had to be that of Canadian impressionist André Philippe Gagnon, who brought to Expo the megastars who recorded We Are the World.
Here's Michael Jackson, Bruce Springsteen, Tina Turner, Dionne Warwick, Stevie Wonder,
Paul Simon, Kenny Rogers, Kenny Loggins, Ray Charles, Bob Dylan, and their friends.
Other things going on in the world besides Expo, including the Seoul Olympics. The Korean stage, one of the most spectacular opening ceremonies we've ever seen, but we at Expo had a sneak preview when they brought to the River Stage their amazing costumes and dancers.
Folk dance is more aesthetic than the Korean fan dance, a dazzling combination of beautiful costumes and geometric patterns.
that type of thing.
Months of Expo, there's been a continuous feast of entertainment. At the Performing Arts Complex, there's been World Expo on stage, a continuous parade of theatre from all over the world. These are the Flying Karamazov brothers. Except their name isn't Karamazov, they aren't even brothers, and they don't fly. but they sure can juggle.
There's only one end of a sickle.
That one can catch more than once.
And now for your
amusement.
All right, here we go.
Ready,
hop, hop, ho.
You ain't seen nothing yet.
Yet.
Da.
Dostoevsky.
Gesundheit.
Oh, thank you.
This is a trick where you can't afford to make too many mistakes.
Whoops. This never happens.
Yeah, hardly ever.
Hardly ever. It's good for the stage. Yeah, they're not sharp or anything, though.
There. There.
It's good as new.
There was nothing fake, though, about these Siberian dancers. They really were from Siberia, and we're told they really are all blonde. An artistic director of the Siberian Cossacks, Mikhail Gorzenko, says when you think about the jewels of Soviet womanhood, you think about beautiful blondes. He also likes the symmetry of a chorus line of blondes. And he admits he just happens to like blondes. While the women are as graceful as dancers from the Bolshoi Ballet, the men in the company are as athletic as the acrobats from the Moscow Circus. For 2 hours every night not only takes its toll on the performers, but on their costumes as well. They travel with more than 1,000 glittering outfits and 350 pairs of shoes. They even have their own shoemaker to check the boots before and after each performance. Was what we in Queensland call winter. But it did cause problems for the performers from the South Pacific. Cold weather or not, the Solomon Islanders came up with one of the most unusual ways of celebrating their national day at Expo. Expo Chairman Sir Lew Edwards and Commissioner General Sir Edward Williams and the Prime Minister of the Solomon Islands were taken for the ride of their life. They were hauled through the startled lunchtime crowds aboard a war canoe, laboriously built at Expo, the first such canoe to be built outside the islands. They were headed for the South Pacific Lagoon, where the war canoe was launched on what would have to be the most unusual lap of honour. It wasn't long before Sir Lew and his fellow crew members were feeling sufficiently brave to stand up in the canoe. Or was it bravery?
I was told to do that, and I guess when the Prime Minister of the Solomon Islands says you better stand up now, I guess I had to do it. But it was absolutely marvellous. It was one of the thrills of Expo, and the people enjoyed it, the people joined in, and to be floating around in this beautiful war canoe on the lagoon with thousands of people cheering from the sideline and waving, enjoying the spirit. I think it was a great day.
I've been around. World Expo 88 attracted a procession of heads of state, royalty and VIPs from all over the world. New Zealand Prime Minister David Lange arrived in style aboard the pocket steamer Puke. Australian Prime Minister Bob Hawke ended up on the river stage for the Australia Day concert. And they all fell victim to the charm of koala diplomacy.
And an old rocking chair. I'll be standing in the kitchen, cooking up a roast.
Uncle Benji might want toast. You and me a cup of tea. Later on we'll settle down and...
When the British Prime Minister visited Expo, the Iron Lady was melting hearts wherever she went. We even caught a rare glimpse of her in full voice at the River Stage, thoroughly enjoying Expo's version of The Last Night of the Proms. The pavilions gave us an idea of life in other lands. It was their music which made it come alive.
A billabong under the shade of a coolie bar tree.
People who have seen World Expo 88 quite the same way as 105-year-old Monty Ponchin. She's probably the only person in the world who can compare this expo with our previous one in Melbourne 100 years ago.
I think it's a wonderful expo, very much more to see, of course, newer things, but not so easy to visit. Not nearly so simple. The previous one was in one building and it was like a series of shops or bazaars open. But here you have to push a little bit and shove a little bit and wait a little bit. It's different in that way. I think the first exposition was well, it was altogether simpler. More, in a way, stodgy. Not so much fun. This is more a fun exposition.
Well, there you have it. 6 months of fun, excitement, good times, and literally millions of happy people. Unfortunately, though, all good things must come to an end. So we do hope our program leaves you with many happy Expo memories. To conclude it, we're going to take one more look at that Expo closing ceremony and the fabulous fireworks which ended our superb World Expo.
We'll be right back.
Good evening. Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. Bonsoir, madame and monsieur. G'day, fellow workers. My name is Mike Williams, your compere for this very special night. Gentlemen, ladies, if you'd be seated. It is now my great pleasure to introduce the chairman of World Expo, the Honourable Sue Llewellyn Edward.
Prime Minister. Mr. Prime Minister. Mr. Prime Minister, Mr. Premier, my Lord Mayor, Ministers, Sir Edward Williams, Dr. Delario, Your Excellencies, Madame Dufresne, Commissioners General, Commissioners and Ladies and Gentlemen. In just 1 hour, World Expo 88 will be closed. The hard work of so many of you have given over such a long period of time has now been completed. The excitement and fun experienced by our visitors will soon become a wonderful memory. Together, we have staged one of the most successful expositions in history. And this success has been brought about by a remarkable commitment and cooperation by many people. Mr. Prime Minister and Mr. Premier, this event, as it draws close, will be remembered as a great event in our history. We believe that Australians have shown great professionalism in staging this event. And when we ask for excellence, for initiative and perseverance from our staff in their performances, we received it. And there is rightly a strong national pride among people from all around Australia for the standards that we have set in this six-month international forum. But above all, Premier and Prime Minister, we believe that we have forged relationships between the nations participating here, which will have an impact for many years. We may have different political and philosophical and cultural backgrounds, but we have come together as one people in creating this great exposition of excellence, of pride and performance. We have become one family, and that spirit of working together must continue in the years that lie ahead. It's now time for World Expo to come to an end. 184 days have come and gone quickly, and together we have given the world pleasure, education, celebration and fun. We have made people smile, and we have made this the happiest place on earth in 1988. And now, as we share the closing ceremony of World Expo 88, and the sun fades on this magnificent sight, and the lights go out for the last time, it is my fervent hope that the spirit of Expo 88 will never fade, and we must make sure that special things that we have enjoyed through this exposition become part of our daily lives from now on. The striving for excellence in our countries, the commitment to doing our best every day, the taking of time to enjoy the companionship of our friends and families, of bringing more fun and happiness into our lives and theirs. For me, it's been a unique privilege and responsibility, and no person could have had a greater privilege or a more enjoyable responsibility. And I have been honoured to share this work with so many wonderful people. Mr. Prime Minister and Mr. Premier, I pay tribute to the Australian people and our visitors from all over the world. We have had millions of visits, and details of those will be given by the Premier and Prime Minister in a moment. But for each and every one of you who have come here, we hope that you will take the spirit of Expo with you in the future. I thank you for all that has been done. It has been a privilege to work with you. And as we part and say goodbye to the many wonderful friends that we have worked with and we have made, I'm sure that there'll always be a little corner in your hearts, which is World Expo 88. I know there will be in mine. Thank you for all of your contribution, and may the light of World Expo 88 never fade.
Ladies and gentlemen, Lou Edwards.
For the international participants, to be a part of World Expo 88, the only international exposition of the Southern Hemisphere in the 20th century, has been a unique experience. And it has also been a very special way to join in your bicentennial celebrations. The Australians have certainly replied in kind, as at the end of the day, it has been the tremendous response of the Australian public what has made possible the success of this exposition and worthwhile our participation. Allow me, on a personal note, to encourage everybody to revive the experience in Spain in the Universal Exposition of Seville 1992. I'm sure you will not be deluded. On behalf of the international participants at World Expo 88 Brisbane, I would like to say thank you, Australia, and goodbye.
Nothing can really succeed without community support. When the Australian community shakes off its prejudices, born of colonial origins, and adopts an event as truly Australian's, its support is universal and wholehearted. Rubbing shoulders with the rest of the world has caused us to look outwards, to assess more closely our true place in the international forum. Hopefully, through Expo 88, we have acquired just a little more of the virtue of humility. We, in this God's own country, owe so much to so many. Thank you all for being a part of our history, for helping us on our way. Thank you very much.
The critics of Expo have been trampled by the, and this is the official number, 18.3 million pairs of feet. million people that marched through the Expo gates. You might say, Expo, put the queue back into Queensland. Ladies and gentlemen, let's not mourn the passing of Expo today. Let's celebrate the discovery of the real Queensland.
Hello, Edwards, Ed Williams, Micah Hearn, Sally Ann Atkinson, Dr. Delario, distinguished guests from overseas and friends one and all. We come towards the end of 1988, but tonight we come to the drawing down of the curtain on what, without any question, has been the greatest single event of the bicentennial year, Expo 88. And as the curtain slowly comes down, it is indeed a time for thank yous. And on behalf of the government and all the people of Australia, I want to extend some thank yous. Firstly of all, of course, I extend on behalf of every single Australian to you, Lou Edwards, an unqualified thank you.
Thank you.
camino un diferente, ahí donde me quieran llevar.
Has come to a close.
Thank you. myself, what a wonderful world. I see skies of blue and clouds of white, the bright blessed day, the dark sacred night. And I think to myself, what a wonderful world. The colors of the rainbow, so pretty in the sky, are also on the faces of people going by. I see friends shaking hands, saying, how do you do? They're really saying, I love you. I hear babies cry. I watch them grow. They learn much more than I never knew. And I think to myself, I think to myself.